I understand that you were raised Serbian Orthodox. What was that like?
Yes, I'm 100% Serb. Second generation in this country. My dad's parents came from Yugoslavia. My mom's parents came from Austria. I was raised in the church. Seldom did I go to church, though. Even though I was a Serb, I would attend church 3 to 6 times a year. I would go to Sunday school during those times. And I was taught Serbian heritage, customs, and the language. Never was I taught the Bible. After Sunday school class was over with, we would assemble ourselves in the church, and we would stand. That's the children and the adults. There were no pews. We would sing. There would be teaching and communion, and that all may sound good, but it was all in Serbian. I understood none of it. What I remembered most about my childhood, though, was not the church experience or the Sunday school experience, because I really didn't learn anything. I loved the picnics, because they would have lamb and pigs on the open spit. I would watch them dance and sing, and they would do this not only at picnic grounds, but they would also do it in the hall, and the food was there, delicious. The pastries were awesome. The dancing was interesting. But what I also saw as a young child, I saw the drinking, the yelling, the carousing, and the profanity. My parents never had a Bible in the house. So what I'm saying, bottom line, is I was not raised in a Christian home. They never taught the Bible. They didn't understand the Bible. And they did the same thing as I saw at picnics. They would drink. They would swear. They had tempers. They were not happy people. And I saw the same thing from my relatives. My godparents, they had businesses that were centered around the alcohol. Bowling alleys with nightclubs. Bowling alleys with bars. And when I would go to these establishments, I thought, well, this is the way it is. And I would hear the swearing because they were drinking, because they were drunk. And to go a step further than that, that's the kind of activity went on after church. They had open bars in the hall next to the church where they drank, where they used profanity, where they would tell bad stories and yell at one another. And what's interesting about all that I'm telling you, and I'm sure that some of you that are watching this message are Serbs, and you maybe relate to it, because yesterday I talked to a young lady who is a little bit younger than me, but she's in her 50s, and I was asking her, and her name I won't give to you at this point during this interview, but I asked her, what did you learn? What did you see? What did you experience? And just what I have told you, she said exactly the same thing. So her experience was like mine. In other words, nothing.
Did you pray to Mary or the saints or angels?
I don't ever remember praying to Mary. It's possible that during the service when the priest would be talking Serbian, he may have been praying to Mary. What I do remember, though, as a child, I had two saints, Saint Sava and Saint Nikola. And I was always told that when I needed something or I was in trouble to pray to those two saints.
Did you confess your sins to the priest?
The only time I ever remember confessing a sin, and I was talking over this over with my wife just today, I remember getting into a fall where I was playing tag, and I accidentally tripped and hit my teeth on a flagpole on school grounds. And I told my parents that I was pushed into that flagpole. And my parents said, they didn't believe me because all the witnesses said that I wasn't pushed and I fell in the flagpole by myself. And my dad said, Steve, is that the truth? And I said, oh, yes, Dad, it's the truth. And he said, would you be willing to tell that to the priest? And I said, oh, yes, I would. But did I go? I don't remember really going, but I was. That was brought up to me. Would you go see the priest and confess what you have told me?
Did you bow before icons or kiss them?
Yes, I did. As a young child, I remember kissing pictures. And I remember here recently, I went with a former church member of mine in St. Petersburg, Florida. We visited the church where my wife and I were married in. And I saw something there that I don't remember as a child, but maybe very common to some of you Serbian people who may be seeing this interview, that they bowed down before where the priest stood. They bowed down before a picture They kissed it. They crossed themselves twice. They got up and went and sat down in the pew. They do have pews now.
What were you taught about salvation?
Nothing.
Did you think that only Serbian Orthodox people were Christians, or did you understand the term Christian?
No, I didn't understand what the term Christian meant. I didn't know any Christians. All I knew about Serbian was what I had mentioned before. It was a ethnic group of people. It was people who met, they spoke the language, they talked about the old country, we shared with food, but it was never about Jesus. It was never about repentance of sins. It was never about obedience.
When you started to read the Bible, what did you notice was different from what you were taught?
Everything, because I never read the Bible. In fact, it was a new thing for me, and it opened up my eyes. In fact, when I accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, and I was born again, I had my hands on a New Testament, and I read it in 1 week. I couldn't put it down. And everything in there was so brand new to me and so refreshing to me. I was so excited to have the Word of God because it spoke to me.
How did you come to learn about the need for repentance for salvation?
Well, it's interesting because it was a process with me. My wife got saved 2 years prior to me. And this woman that I married, I saw her as being, before we were married, and we were equally yoked, neither one of us were raised in Christian homes, but what I saw in her life was a new person. I didn't recognize her anymore. Yes, she looked like the same person, but she wouldn't drink with me. She wouldn't talk in an unchristian way, not that she always did, but she wasn't the same person that I married. And I watched this behavior over a period of 2 years. In fact, my wife, as she was growing in Christ, she would have the Word of God in her hand, and she would follow me around the house as I was shaving or eating food, and she would read me a scripture. She would say, "Steve, listen to this." And I'd turn, and I'd listen. And through that time, it would click. And because that went on for 2 years, I never rejected it, but yet I still hadn't made a commitment yet.
When and how did you make a commitment?
My wife and I were attending a church in Sarasota. And if I could go back just a little bit, in 1974, our first child was born. And a minister from a Presbyterian church visited. And he invited us to his church. And I said, "Hey, that's great." And I found out they had a softball team. And that's what appealed to me. It wasn't the fact going to church, but it was the fact that I could play softball for the church team. And what I heard from the pulpit, I thought, well, this is the world. Because the pastor behind the pulpit would always talk about his assistant, how women were more attracted to his assistant than to him. And we would have Sunday school parties once a month. And the leader of the Sunday school class would invite his whole class. And since I was in the whiskey business, listen to that, I was in the whiskey business, obviously I was not saved yet, and I would bring the wine, and my wife would teach them how to dance. And we would watch marriages break up right before our eyes, and we would scratch our heads and go, "Why?" And then after 1974, 1978 came, and my wife met a lady who led her to the Lord, and she was born again. And I was still in the whiskey business. I was still a whiskey salesman. And in 1978, the Lord's direction, the business started to crumble. My income started to drop. And then a short time thereafter, I started to seek new employment. The Lord led me to a seafood company where I eventually got hired, and I had a wonderful career. But during that career, early years, I still didn't know Jesus. And then in 1980, on a business trip, I had heard about Washington for Jesus. And I put it on my calendar, and I wanted to go because things were happening to me in my life. And I wanted to see more what Christ had to offer. And on an airplane trip to Washington for Jesus, there was an Assembly of God minister and his associate sitting behind me. And I was sitting in the first class cabin because I traveled so much I was able to get those upgrades. And there was a mother with her child sitting next to me, and the child was screaming and yelling and even was spitting up on my suit. And I started to get upset and understand I had a sign of the fish on my lapel. And I remember the minister looking at him behind me, and he was going like this. And I was trying to think, what is he doing? But what he was doing, it was, and I finally picked up on it, you know, young man, you've got a sign of your fish on your lapel, and you're not looking like a Christian. So I stopped my behavior, and as the flight landed in D.C., and we got off the plane, the minister grabbed me by the shoulder and said, could we talk to you? And I said, well, sure. He said, tell me about your life in Christ. I said, well, I don't know anything. My wife is saved, and she is a brand new person. He said, well, listen, could I talk with you tonight? And he called me, and he did. And he said, can I meet with you tomorrow morning? And he and his associate laid hands on me, prayed for me. And I was so excited about receiving Christ as my Lord and Savior and being born again, I called my wife no less than 6 times. You see, this is so different than from my raising as a Serbian Orthodox. I knew nothing. There was no excitement there whatsoever. And here I found my Savior, my Jesus.